Welcome to the Elevate Your Equity Podcast, where we, as married busy professionals, leverage real estate investing to unlock the 3+1 degrees of freedom, health, location, time, and financial.
Today, we've got the wonderful Stefan Tsvetkov. He is the founder of RealtyQuant, which is at www.realtyquant.com, a company that brings data-driven and quantitative techniques to the real estate industry. He is on a mission to add massive industry value through education, investment, technology, and analytics. Stefan, great to have you on the show. How are you today?
Doing well. How about you?
We're great. We're great. So let's just go ahead and jump right in. I know that today we're going to be talking about data-driven real estate investing, but generally for our guests, we'd like to talk about how you got started and interested investing in real estate and how that led you to today. So if you could give us a little bit of a story about who you are and where you came from, that'd be awesome.
Absolutely. Yes. So I'm Eastern European. So I came here for my master's degree. And I did studied financial engineering in New York City. And then I was working in finance for about a decade. And so the way I started in real estate is first, it's kind of perhaps a little bit trite in a sense, like with house hacking. So I had just moved to New Jersey, right by New York City. And I bought a fourplex. One of the units happened to be pretty spacious and nice and had a nice terrace. And that's, I was pretty happy with it. And I was living, kind of COVID rent-free, now you have all kinds of expenses after this to owning a property, right? But that's how I started. So I thought it's pretty nice. You get nice cash flow, or in this case, kind of implicitly rent-free. And there was some inefficiency to the purchase as well. It was relatively cheap, compared to its appraisal. It was a divorced, a person going through a divorce, selling it. So it was actually a relatively good deal. So that's how I got started first. As far as the house hacking, that was back in 2017. Didn't do much after that, perhaps. Yes. Still going to work and so forth. Yeah, so in more recent, in the recent 2-3 years, I've been full-time in real estate.
Excellent, excellent, cool. So what got you really excited about real estate investing? Was it the house hacking where you realized, oh my gosh, I could be living, if I can do this with my private residence, then I can start doing this with rental property? Is that how it all kind of started? Or give us a little bit more background about what got you excited about real estate in particular?
Yes. I mean, the first thing is I feel that many people perhaps feel buy a house, you kind of get the sense of leverage, if you will. Now, you didn't commit that much funds, but you suddenly have a huge house, right? So that's in itself a little bit of a mental effect, how to say now. It's maybe not too rational, but still, that's due to leverage. So from there, to your point, yeah, it's just realizing it seems it has something good investment properties, properties as an investment, so to say, or qualities as an investment, and compared to finance, traditional finance stocks and so forth. So I just thought I can, start looking for deals and kind of utilize my skills as a trader in finance, essentially to sort of trade the real estate market in a similar way, in a data-driven way. And so I started writing, my Python scripts and doing codes and searching for different deals around New York City. And so that's how I got started.
Excellent. Well, let's talk about those early days then. How did you go from getting, being a house hacker and understand there's this technology here that you could be leveraging? How did you go from that to actually doing it? I know you mentioned Python and writing scripts and looking at data. Let's talk about the early days when you got your business up and running. What did you end up doing with that software that you built in the early days?
Yeah, so I ended up essentially, I would pull, let's say, all the on-market and some off-market, data around New York City. So kind of within, it was all residential. And I've been transitioning to a commercial more recently and bidding on different properties in the Midwest and that. But at the time was all residential. Essentially, what I would do, I would just pull about 6,000 multifamilies, small multifamily properties, 2 to 4 units, maybe 5-6 units, something like that, in the New York City area, and within 3 hours, three state area call it as well. And I would just have them automatically underwritten. So data-driven investing, I think one component is just having automated underwriting. If you can underwrite everything in an automated manner, that saves you time, that also helps you to do it at scale, that also allows you to sort of invest even on market, which is a little bit counterintuitive since I know like most investors, they're averse to that. They only look for deals like off market, but I was able to find like amazing deals off the MLS like that. Because if you have like 6,000 of them, you know, and you look at the top 0.1%, you know, or something like that, it's a different thing. So they kind of have it in a, you know, just more rigorous approach. And yeah, so what it brought is it was just really different strategies. My second deal was like small, like condo building that had, I kind of like purchased the building and then it had the condos were non-warrantable at the time. That was 2018. And they were, so non-warrantable meaning they don't qualify for conventional financing. But there was kind of this spread between like what, if they were warrantable, like what condos normally cost and this sort, this kind of package price for the deal. And then I've done like condominium conversions as well, like sort of like searching with data, like the discrepancy between multifamily price and condo prices and doing that also in New York City. I converted a 4-unit into a 5-unit, sort of where the 5th unit already existed, and sort of doubling its valuation. Mm. So that's something also you can search more efficiently with data. Like you can search like all kinds of like little things, you know, like even if it's a double address, you know, sometimes, or if it's kind of try to discover something that's classified as a 4-plex, but maybe actually has 5 units or something like that. And there's being sold residential, but you could, you know, the seller is not realizing that actually this could have a commercial appraisal that could be worth more. You know, that's another strategy. You know, various cash flow strategies, like looking for like cash flow properties upstate, like things that would have like, I don't know, 15 cap or 20 cap, you know, like, yeah, kind of like small, you know, like just to build up your cash flow and like kind of financial independence. I did that as well. Also some, what I was doing, another thing is kind of like small, like renovation projects. And I would try to discover which ones are undervalued. So like that it's like a gut rehab, and then sell those with seller financing to another investor or something like this. Mm. And so kind of like flip like renovation project that you don't actually, it was all very stabilized without renovating anything myself. Now in more recent years, I switched more to like renovating stuff, but at the time was kind of like just finding it's a flip. It's really a flip, but I don't actually want to renovate anything. So it's just because I use data, because I invest all my time to build up, you know, those processes and scripts and kind of to discover something that's actually in stabilized condition, but still has some kind of value add to it in a regulatory, right, or different. So that those are like some examples. And more recently in the commercial space, and I've been doing that in a data-driven way, which is quite interesting, actually. I can talk to that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's explore that. Let's talk about this, because what I'm curious is you've given us a lot of examples of what you've used your data or a data-driven approach to help find deals for you, right? Let's drill into the details a little bit. Like, how does your process work? Like, what do you do right now? Do you have like a list of properties that you have a whole bunch of, like, you know, think of it like a spreadsheet, right? Where you've got an address and then you have, you know, the owner and then a bunch of different fields, like number of units, any leverage if it's on it, kind of like what you can get off of a Reonomy or you can buy data, right? First of all, where does your data come from? And then secondly, how are you manipulating the data to find some of these, like, either human errors, you know, these human entry errors or these opportunities? I want to hear more about that on the back end.
Good. And that's a great question, actually. Yes. I mean, you mentioned Reonomy, and I'm sure like some of your audience is acquainted like other feeds like Prospect Now and so forth, especially used in the commercial, like direct to owner, like direct to seller campaigns and that. And yeah, so what I do is commercial space, I pull rental listings data from places such as apartments.com. There are different vendors that service this data. One vendor is called Datafinity. So they would kind of go online and they would just kind of web scrape, you know, like a ton of, you know, like data from apartments.com, apartment finder, realtor.com, et cetera, And so when you're saying like in terms of like, what is the difference versus let's say having something like Reonomy? So if you have Reonomy, okay, you may have like, you have the inventory, you have like information, kind of like the tax county, you know, information, you have perhaps like some sense of the valuation of that property, like what it's approximately worth. And there may be like signals, you know, as to like motivated sellers and things like that, or like information for like the owner, right? Kind of like finding the owner, like the owner address or phone number, email, et cetera. So this is all useful, but it's a kind of, let's say, static data that doesn't have a modeling, financial modeling to it. So what I do is like kind of more the financial modeling on top of that, where I would use rental listings data to derive inventories for commercial multifamily. and then model the rental listings data to infer which buildings have the bigger value add. So this kind of, I think, a very good approach. I think like many people can do it. I feel it's underutilized. And so essentially, what do you get from rental listings data? You get, are the rents below market compared to the immediate neighborhood, immediate, the same property class? But also you get kind of an insight into those other revenue streams of a property. Now, are they charging, you know, pet fees, administrative fees, like all those other income components if they're efficiently utilized? And what utilities are they billing to tenants is something that gets contained in rental listings as well. And then you can get a sort of a estimate, try to estimate based on like how many postings they're putting out there, you know, perhaps a sense, get a sense into their like relative occupancy rate. And so this is like high level modeling. But if you think about what's happening in the commercial multifamily investment space, it's you have, you're given an income expense sheet by an agent, and then you kind of work on that income, you know, you just kind of underwrite the property, you know, like yourself, like look at all parameters, and you try to judge, you know, underwrite, like judge if it is a good deal. But you cannot actually do it in a data-driven at scale way. Now, if you wanted to do that, that's essentially like what I'm suggesting with rental listings. So that gives you an income expense, a glimpse into the income expense sheet of thousands and thousands of properties. And I did like a webinar on the topic actually at my, like my webinar series, Finance Meets Real Estate. And I, where I showed actually doing this for like about 32,000 properties in like any market. So I'm like, it's just a very different way where I would say I build my own marketing list on one side, but those marketing lists, they have financial modeling in it. So that's what is unique, because if you get prospect now or you get other vendors, there's typically no financial modeling. There's no sense. Like what I'm really doing is like, I try to rank all buildings in, if it's, let's say, Atlanta, Georgia, I try to rank all off-market inventory based on which buildings show the biggest potential for value add. Mm-hmm. Now, to investors who are very focused within a single location, then they say, okay, oh, well, how do you care about this? Because now I can just send direct mail to all the off-market inventory anyways, without even financially modeling them, right?
Sure.
It's like, okay, that comes then to the market side. Like that's the other question. Now, if you're so focused on a single market, you know, perhaps that could be due to agent relationships. There are many reasons in real estate to be focused on a single market, but in itself is not, I'd say, like very data-driven. Because how about if you were in Florida, let's say, or Texas, which are grew on a very broad-based basis? So let's say like where nearly every county appreciated very strongly, which is not the case, for example, in Georgia or in North Carolina, but let's say Florida and Texas that had like multiple counties, like a big percentage of their counties appreciate really much. So in that scenario, you can actually do, you know, prospecting where you actually model, like, for example, I can pull like all the inventory in Florida, let's say, and literally like all off market inventory and kind of find sort of a direct to owner, you know, like 50 different counties. And let's say perhaps just the top 25% of the buildings in those counties, you know, like just as an example. And that's kind of a more potentially like more intelligent approach to that campaigning, because okay, whoever picks up the phone, I know, or calls me back or something like that, I know in the first place, I have some preliminary underwriting for that already. So that speeds the process. So this is an example in the commercial space. Yeah, and coming to the market side, it's very important, like another, so financial modeling is a data-driven technique in itself. One can say, you know, automated underwriting, we touched on. There are other aspects. For residential investors, there's automated valuation. Like there's things like Zillow's estimate. So one can do that. Now, so to people who are like very tech savvy, like there's ways to do it in Python yourself to value houses. It's not overly complex, like a really basic model to value houses. It's probably 5 lines of code, actually. Mm-hmm. A much more complicated one would take like much more time, right? But it's quite interesting, but that can help you like discover like pricing efficiency, like find like properties that even they could be listed by agents, but they're perhaps mispriced. Automated underwriting had other like technology side, which is, I would say, like valuable, where you need to perhaps condition score properties sometimes. And again, that's also more on the residential side. And condition scoring gets achieved via machine learning. It's kind of the only way. So it's kind of like reading photos via like computer vision algorithms. So a company in New York that does it is Foxy AI, for example. I don't do it at RealtyQuant specifically as far as the computer vision, but they do natural language processing for property descriptions. Kind of, you don't need to read like thousands of descriptions. Perhaps you can kind of categorize you know, the data in a more kind of more intelligent way. And so that is, those are like other like data-driven techniques, just kind of mentioning, putting out there for your audience, like very high level. And market side, so just like briefly on the market side, since I mentioned like the perspective where real estate is very vocal, right? And most investors, they kind of focus and build either they're perhaps vertically integrated or, you know, like they build their team at a single place, right? In itself, like there could be a different approach. It's always hard to scale in real estate in you either across properties or across markets in different ways, like with different challenges. But still on the market side, it's very important. So what do we do on the market side? So one thing is to compute downside risk measures. So this is something I think that I know several people who do it. So Ingo Winzer at Local Market Monitor. So Neil Bauer uses Local Market Monitor. It's one person who does it. There are studies at Dallas Fed, I guess, or something like that. There is Florida Atlantic University has a study, and there is a study for different countries by Bloomberg Economics. So those are like different sources that give you like market valuations data, call it. And my company, RealtyQuant, is actually, I would say, like there as well. So we publish, well, we are actually the only company that publishes market valuations data for like 2,700 US counties. So what market valuations means, again, like in speaking to the data-driven investing side and on the markets, not the property side, it really means what is your estimator of downside risk and where is the market currently relative to fundamentals? Is it 10% overvalued, 20% overvalued, this kind of perspective? And fundamentals are the fundamentals of income, population, and housing supply. And so that is another thing. So that's another thing that I do. And I do some of appreciation forecasting as well. And so that market data, like for forecasting as well as downside risk for, you know, almost every county in the country is available at RealtyQuant and something that is provided to others as well. Since like a lot of the other data-driven methods are actually kind of in-house, you know, I just use them in kind of in my own investment process. Yeah, so it's very interesting market valuation. It's a very interesting topic actually, because it changed kind of like it was a different narrative before 2021. Like I was at events like at the beginning of COVID, and that's when I started doing like some of those studies of like market valuation in real estate. And in the beginning of COVID, it was the narrative was always US real estate is fairly valued. And that continued actually until the first quarter of 2021, which is quite interesting to some investors, I feel, because like many investors felt it's already overvalued then, right? And many investors are always concerned. Yeah. Real estate is expensive. It wasn't really the case. It was the case in a few Western states. Well, Idaho was the most notable example already at the beginning of COVID, was actually around 25% overvalued in kind of relative to fundamentals. And that's, and again, like this measure is if someone thinks like, okay, what does this really mean? After the global financial crisis, this same metric, deviation from population, income, housing supply, showed like 85% correlation at the state level versus the subsequent actual declines. So for example, like the big declines were in California, Florida, Nevada, Arizona, like 40 to 56%, excuse me, like for Nevada, the higher number. And so they were actually overvalued in the same, in this measure, like 40 to 60%. And then the undervalued, there were around 10 states that were undervalued at the time, negative market valuation. And they actually dropped only 4% on average, which is quite interesting. And 4% was the median income drop in the US at the time. So you can say, if you think in kind of like affordability, like price to income terms, you can say that valuations, like price to income valuations, call it, they stayed the same in those states. So it's, which is very interesting observation at the time. So bottom line, it's fundamentals do seem predictive price decline when it comes to real estate. It's harder in the stock market, like come out of like trading background in finance. It's harder in the stock market to have the technology sector. In real estate, it is very fundamental, easier to model. And so that's why I kind of do that route as well as like producing this data. And that's very much used in my investing. So this is like having measures of downside risk is extremely important. We have people going now in some of like the very trendy markets. Those trendy markets, they could as well be fairly valued. It just happens to be already now they're not. Now, some of them were okay until 2021 and so forth, but inflation changed the state of market valuations, and they kind of really rallied up because simply incomes didn't respond to inflation. And other, you know, like even like population and housing supply sort of less dollar value, you know, sort of like other fundamentals, they didn't move accordingly as well. And so that is kind of, you know, so that is another like that-driven technique. I feel it's, I know like a few people who use it. I mean, there's people around me who use it. And obviously like people who use our data use it as well. It generally, like most investors feel they're guessing the market. So they're always like, what if the market hit a peak? Is it, you know, what if should I sell my property and so forth? And so for me, this was like a big step as like a professional investor to get like kind of to wrap my head around the market side. It's much less time consuming than properties, I would say, but it's a very useful thing. It's relatively easy to, if your audience, if they want to reach to me, it's actually, I can guide them through even like doing some of those studies themselves. They are so inclined, if they're kind of like finance inclined and so forth.
Yeah, no, that's great. A lot of interesting stuff here. And I love the approach of the downside risk. And some of the, one of my questions that I was going to ask you was, what variables do you look at, right? Because I have a data-driven approach as well when I start underwriting properties. Mm-hmm. At least I like to think about it in a certain way. Like for example, one method that I use is whenever I'm looking at multifamily, I will look at Zillow Rentals or Craigslist or, you know, some place for single family homes, because that data seems to be more available since there's more management companies that need that outreach in Zillow Rentals or Premium Rental or whatever, right? Sure, and so you can set assumptions based on how much a single family home is going for with similar finish and similar square footage and, you know, a yard and things like that. You can make an assumption for how much a rental unit inside of an apartment building would go for by looking at that data, right? And so you can kind of correlate the two. So I like to zero in on like what the upper limit is by saying if a single family house is going for $1,000, we're sure as heck not getting $1,000 for a rental unit, or we shouldn't be, right? And that's certain and a variable and assumption I like to make. And so I think you touched on a lot of those variables that you look at in market and in the property driven approach. So that's awesome. And I think it'll be worth going back and listening to again. At least that's what I'm going to do. But one thing I wanted to ask you was, given where we are right now, I have a couple of questions. The first is, what markets do you think right now are undervalued and which ones are overvalued as we record this in the middle of quarter two in 2022?
That's a great question. One thing is to actually, I have the data at year end 2021. So that's as far as it goes. The reason is it though it's lagging by one quarter. So it's lagging by one quarter. I can get the prices anywhere. I can get the prices on Zillow and so on and so forth. But the real fundamentals, you know, things like income, you know, housing supply, population, you know, they come from governmental agencies. So it's always like at least a quarter to a quarter and a half behind. So where things at year end 2021, really? Well, broadly, the West, Western markets got more overvalued with inflation. So specifically the five smaller Western states of Idaho, Arizona, Utah, and Colorado. So Idaho is like at the very top, nearing 50%. And again, like just the most negative story. I mean, not negative, it's not, it's actually, they're also the best performing ones, right? So they're also extremely well performing. So it's like, I run appreciation forecasts and my highest appreciation forecasts are in Idaho as well. Something that is overvalued, that's not a good predictor of appreciation. This is a good predictor of downside only because real estate, there are tests for like momentum in real estate, like via like autocorrelation and other ways. And real estate has lots of momentum. So actually, for example, like in Florida, it's like close to 80% like momentum compared to like last year. Let's say it's this year versus last year kind of thing. So it's actually interesting that if something is overvalued, it still gets the highest appreciation forecast if I run like kind of like forecasting. So because that's the only thing, the trend is going to continue until it stops. But this is your measure whenever we reach it an uncertain timing. So timing completely uncertain. This is your measure of downside risk afterwards, assuming we had a kind of like a global financial crisis kind of correction. So Idaho is at the top. And then I guess like Nevada and Arizona are like in the like 25-30% range. And then Colorado, Utah, right after this. And so like these five states, like five smaller Western states, they're at the top. Then the southern states of like the big multifamily states of Florida and Texas, they reach like around, I believe like around 21%. So they're also kind of like bigger states. And to clarify, like all of these measures were like at least in half or less at the beginning of 2021. So just a year ago, all of these measures were, if we take Arizona 30%, it was at 14% only at the beginning of 2021. Wow. So like very recent inflation development over a very short time. It was just like fairly valued before. That's basically the story. And that's like consistent with Bloomberg economics, consistent with actually like some of the other studies that are out there. Use like different relatively different methods, but high level in line. And so, which are the undervalued? Undervalued at the current point in the cycle, given we are like already like 10, 12 years into the market cycle, it's only the depressed one. So it's only really the Northeast, broadly speaking, is undervalued. So the Northeast, if a big decline happens, is it going to drop? Probably no, it's going to drop like 4%. And so generally, there can be exceptions. There can be, you know, your neighborhood is really booming and something, you know, happens in your specific neighborhood. Of course, it's more woke than that, but high level speaking, not very big drops there. And the Midwest is fairly valued. West, smaller states, kind of very overvalued. California is fairly valued, actually. So there you go. So that's like the narrative of California being undesired. California,
it's too bad. It's too bad, though, that they have such terrible tenant landlord laws, though.
Policy
issue. Yeah,
exactly. I agree. No, I'm not. And again, that's what I'm saying. That's not an appreciation predictor. That's not, doesn't mean I'm bullish on California. I'm just saying that's what their measure of downside risk. And so it's quite interesting because, you know, like people would say California is expensive, Nevada is cheap. Well, depends. In absolute terms, California is expensive, but it's relatively cheap still. But again, compared to the fundamentals that are going over the long run, at the moment, Nevada is expensive, California is, well, fairly valued. And something like New Jersey is cheap. And so that's the kind of how it ends up. Again, it's reflective of their relatively poor appreciation as well that they have had, like places like New Jersey. There are exceptions. So what are like good markets to invest in my opinion? So my general opinion is it's relatively risk averse. I feel like most investment managers should start rebalancing their portfolio towards, you know, places like the Midwest. I just feel it's the time for that. That is just my sense. There is a private equity fund, actually, I'm speaking for like later today, that they did like this kind of strategy where they actually, they changed, they sent to their investor list, we are going to be investing only secondary and tertiary markets in the Midwest. And that's considering some of the yield curve inversion and other considerations there. And again, like we know like what investors in places like Phoenix, Arizona, they're kind of making a fortune right now. And it's really great. But it's just, again, like even if they are, the question is for new acquisitions, what do you do? And so for new acquisitions, it seems to me like it's the strategy is kind of to allocate to place like Indiana, Kentucky states, you know, and we can talk like more specific markets as well.
You know, what's interesting is I've actually been, so I'm deeply involved in Indianapolis and some of the surrounding areas and also Louisville and Evansville, some of those like tertiary and secondary markets. Over the last year and a half, I have seen purchase prices go for, you know, C-class product that's maybe, I don't know, it would be a stretch to call them stabilized. I guess they're stabilized at lower rents than market. So I don't know if that's actually stable or not. I'd say no. But those properties, I used to see those coming in at 65, 70 a door for C-class, or maybe even 55, like in that realm, 50 to 55. Now it's trading for 75. And that's only been happening in the last year or two. And there was like a B-plus, A-class, A-minus asset that I was looking at in a wealthy suburb of Indianapolis. And it was 500 units. And I was going to take this thing down, and a fair price for it at the time back in 2020 or in 2021 was like $95,000 a door. That seemed to make sense. A hedge fund came in and bought at $125,000 a door at the time. And that's for B plus A minus stabilized assets. And that surprised me when I saw that. Now I'm seeing A class product in Indianapolis going for like $150,000, you know, $140,000, $150,000 a door. And C and B class going for somewhere between 70 and 90, and then up about around 100, and newer construction even at 130 in the suburbs. And so I think that the fact that you said about, you know, being fairly valued, it's true, because the rents, they're equitable. Like the 1% rule of saying, hey, you know, whatever the market rent is, if you can get your monthly rent is 1% of the per door purchase price, then you're in good shape. And that's still achievable in the Midwest in the multifamily space. It's getting harder, but it's still achievable. So that all makes sense there. And I think that I'm really understanding what you're saying here.
Well, I mean, just like with one caveat, just to say, like to respond to like what you're mentioning, and I've been myself, like let's say my most recent bid, like again, on the kind of risk averse side, like speaking, was like a 48 unit in Des Moines in Iowa. So that's, you know, a fairly kind of, you know, not like the super booming market, right? But again, like it's that specific market was like, I believe like around 2% undervalued in this kind of perspective. And so it's, again, like this is my personal like risk tolerance at the current time. But one thing, like it's the caveat to what you said, is really commercial multifamily, to your earlier point, it's harder, even with a CoStar subscription and so forth, it's harder to have this kind of amazing data where you can model forecast appreciation and model downside risk. And so this, just as a caveat, this is the broad like FHFA, Federal Housing Finance Agency data, which is really kind of like more like ties to single family and small multifamily space. But that's like very important. Right. We did a study where like the commercial multifamily cost, well, NAREIT index by CoStar commercial multifamily index versus FHFA was actually 91% correlation kind of over the long run. In price terms. So, you know, like it's over the long run, it should kind of wash out, but it's really different, of course, we know. It's a different valuation method. So like some of the things you're seeing in Indianapolis and so forth, it's just very hard to gauge like specifically commercial multifamily valuations, but it is on some level moving in line because like if we take, let's say some of the Arizona overvaluation that happened in the residential space, and then we observe it in commercial space kind of as well with all the immense rent growth that happened and like people like exiting and doing like amazingly profitable like exits, right? Which is great, but over a very short timeline. And so it does seem to kind of intuitively be somewhat aligned. So I don't think it's like really too different, but of course, yes, for a very specific market zip code and or even city, things can deviate. You can have perhaps commercial multifamily go really high and then single family homes are not and the other way around. And definitely possible, but the broad trends are still like, it's fundamentally still the same asset, right? It's just places for people to live, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's income approach, whether it's comparables approach, fundamentally it's based on, you know, incomes, population, and housing supply. So it's just kind of a short-term, a little bit noise to it. That noise can be extremely impactful to you, to your investment, because you're just there for a short term, right? You're there for 5 years, 2 years, and so forth. From a broader market perspective, the two ought to converge at some point, more or less, over the long run. Yeah, it's very, very interesting what you mentioned as far as like Louisville and Indianapolis and that.
Yes, absolutely. So I've been seeing evidence of what you're saying, and I understand the caveat that, you know, the data is not completely one-to-one, but I can just tell you from what it looks like from an investor buyer standpoint and from what my tenants are doing, right? So at least from my sample set of working in Indianapolis and that part of the Midwest. I have one last question for you before we head into the rapid round. And that is probably as a curious question for many people out there, what trends are you seeing right now in data, at least, you know, delayed back a couple of quarters, right? That you think we as investors, as all investors, should be paying more attention to? Like, are you seeing any red flags, like too much overvaluation, too much money printing, or, you know, how the overall macroeconomics of our policy, our government policy, is tying into what you're seeing in the data? Anything that you can extract from your, you know, from all your number crunching and combing through these mountains of data and research?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a great question. When we mentioned some of the valuations in the West, I think that's something people should be paying more attention to, specifically, like I mentioned, with regards to perhaps rebalancing portfolios for new acquisitions, you know, at least as far as that perspective. So that is just my personal view. Again, like I know how well those markets are doing. That's, you know, something also seen in the data. But again, like, so this is one. Another thing actually I can mention from the, so used to be like a derivatives trader in finance. And so like another thing to watch on the, I'm sure like people saw like some of the yield curve inversion in like in the treasury bond market. So another thing I want to say, like since many people are concerned about mortgage rates. So now, and that's interest rates are very hard to predict. So this is sort of with a very big, you know, uncertain, much more uncertain, I would say, than valuation, you know, in that sense, statement. But generally, like the trend to me where we seem to be is, for example, 2018, we had a Fed hiking rates. So mortgage rates spiked in 2018 as well. Then inversion, then curve inversion in 2019, rates actually going down into a bond rally. Bond rally is when people are buying too many bonds, essentially. So rates going down. And then there is a huge bond rally at the beginning of recession. So when the COVID, quote unquote, recession, very short recession that was started, I was trading, you know, kind of with a Bloomberg screen, you know, at work. And there was like a huge bond rally when the recession started. And so that is, generally speaking, I feel like one dynamic to watch now because, okay, we have the rate hikes, mortgage rates rallied super much. But I feel like people are expecting mortgage rates to go like much, much higher. And that is not the baseline scenario, I feel, because the baseline scenario is, okay, mortgage rates correlate to the 10-year treasury rate. people don't hold their mortgages for 30 years, kind of like more like 10 years or something like this. And so, yeah, so it's kind of like driven by the 10-year treasury rate. So 10-year treasury rate increased a lot with the reflecting like the Fed hike expectations. Okay, but the general trend, at least, or what we saw like after 2019, what I expect now is so then to go into a bond rally. And if we experience a recession, which could be a very short recession, could be a longer one, we don't know. But the very short recession seems a very high likelihood, like just by the yield curve inversion, like probabilities and that. And so if we experience a very short recession, then it's actually the baseline scenario is a big bond rally when this happens. And so mortgage rates then to go down. So this is like one thing just to mention, since I hear like what's of the interest rate concerns, they're relatively varied. I just feel that, you know, recessions, they correlate with low interest rates. So that's, we're just at the earlier stage and people kind of panic about that because there's like all the rate hikes, but they're already reflected in the 10-year treasury rates, they're already reflected in mortgage rates. So that's one thing to kind of keep in mind, that as the market cycle progresses, we ought to, or like kind of one baseline or one expectation is to see a bond rally first and then to see that. And then like some comments on the like perhaps like stock market is like stock market has like volatility index like VIX, and we're over time actually now Derek and yeah, so let's say VIX is like the volatility index in the stock market, and so VIX is not at that high levels now even with some of the decline in the stock market, and unless the market structures changed, so I'm just looking for like kind of signals for even from the stock market like some of weakening that could not may not affect real estate, like we don't know, right? But just a sort of like the general economy. So in the stock market, so VIX is around 30 right now today. So it's not like at a particularly high level of volatility, the stock market. And during like COVID, it actually spiked like way, way higher. And so unless the market structure, the stock market structure changed, VIX ought to be much higher for us to be like in a more forward stage, because it's actually was observed at the time, and that like speaking as a trader in finance at the time, was that there was lots of like volatility control funds in the market that were kind of like dumping equities when the market starts going down. And we haven't seen that yet. And that was like really exploding the VIX. So that just hasn't happened yet. So that's what I'm trying to say. So that would be so a higher spike in like stock market volatility and higher in the bond rally ought to, if we kind of follow like the general trend that we seem to be in, it might change, we never know, right? Then that ought to follow and then we have a recession. And so that's kind of like, right. Just like kind of some expectations. So just like tying to like people's concerns about like mortgage rates and so on and so forth. And yield curve inversion generally has like, it's considered to have a 98% probability for recession within 2 years. That doesn't mean, because that recession could be very small. And also that recession could be no drop in real estate whatsoever, like it was with COVID as well, and then things going well. So it's pretty hard to say like very specifically, but these are just like some like data points that I consider. And market valuation extremely important, because again, like there's no timing to where declines could happen, but this is your measure of risk. And in real estate, I kind of really kind of urge people to, I would say like to pay attention to that stuff, because it's not the stock market. This is not like crazy uncertain stuff. It's very fundamental. So you can kind of have a sense of your downside risk. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very interesting. I think there's something about the stock market that correlates well with the overall economy, which of course reflects on real estate, because if people aren't working, then they can't pay their rent. And then that reflects back. And it's like this big cycle. Mm-hmm. Everything is all interconnected. So I appreciate this. We could be talking about this for a really long time, and I appreciate all this information. It's really good stuff. In the interest of time, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move to the rapid round, which is the same 5 questions that I asked every one of our guests. And so we're going to ask them to you, and they're meant to be answered in about 30-second time frame or less if possible. And we're going to rapidly ask them to you real quick if you're ready for it. Are you ready?
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, cool. Question number 1. What book would you say has had the biggest impact on you and why? And hopefully it's not Rich Dad, Poor Dad, or the Bible, because we get those a lot.
Yes. Well, I don't know. I guess When Genius Failed was a book I read in undergrad. So it's kind of like a finance book about the hedge fund, long-term capital management during the 98 Russian debt crisis. So it's kind of like an introduction to like, I guess like finance and arbitrage. And it has affected me. Perhaps it has affected me, considering that's sort of like what I try to do and the mindset that I have now in real estate as well.
Sure. Excellent. Love that. All right. We'll put that in the show notes. 2, if people wanted to emulate your success, what do you think is the first actionable thing that they could do to follow in your footsteps?
Go to our website.
learn all the data, learn how to how to look at all this data this way. I love that. It's awesome. Number three, what is one tool, process, or hack in the last 3 months that's helped you personally save time and or effort?
Looking for like help online, kind of like virtual assistant help. And yes, that has helped me a lot.
Excellent. Has that happened in the last 3 months or so?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So I've been, that one hasn't fully realized yet. I've been working for an acquisitions analyst, actually, kind of remote acquisitions analyst. But yeah, that one not fully saved me time.
Yeah, but I love it though. I love that you're thinking like that already and it's in progress. So that's definitely something we recommend for everyone. All right, number four, if the people you know had to describe you with one word, what do you think that word would be?
Analytical.
Love it. I definitely can see that. All right. And then number five, what small thing do most people not know about you?
Most people don't know I'm Bulgarian. I don't know my nationality, I guess. I mean, they know that's foreigner, but yeah. So
yeah, no, that's cool. Or do you go back there every once in a while? Or
Yeah. After COVID, it kind of reduced, but I would go like every other year usually. Something like
awesome. That. That's cool. It's good to see you have extended family there, right?
Yeah, of course.
Awesome. Well, hey, you know, Stefan, thank you so much for coming on the show. What I want to do now is I want to give you a space to be able to tell our listeners how they can find out more about what you have going on. So,
Yeah, absolutely. So, realtyquant.com, I mentioned earlier, that's my website. So, I'm starting a data-driven real estate investing course later this year. So kind of on the education side. And also there we have market valuations data. So some of the downside risk and like appreciation discussion we had for like 2,700 US counties. So that's something people feel can benefit at the, you know, the current time, get on our investor list as well. Finance Meets Real Estate on YouTube. So that's my name and Finance Meets Real Estate. So that's my YouTube channel.
Awesome. And we'll be linking to all those inside the show notes so that people, if they want to get a hold of you, they can just go to the show notes, no matter where they're listening or watching this, and they can do that. So Stefan, thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your wisdom with us. It's really great stuff.
Thank you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And for your listeners out there who have listened all the way to this point, I want to thank you guys. Wherever you're watching this or listening to it, please make sure that you thumbs up, you like, subscribe, and you comment so that we can get more interaction and we can appease the algorithm gods and find more and more people to listen to the show and bring on awesome guests like Stefan as well. So I want to thank you, dear listener. Thank you very much for your listenership. You guys take care. Have an awesome rest of the week. We'll see you guys next time. This is Derek signing off.